And good morning, and do you hear me also in the back?
Yes,
very good. Okay, as said, I'm Frank Martela, and I come from the University of Helsinki. I'm from this Philosophian Akatemia. And as said also that I have written like, my research is about this like inner motivation or self-motivation has been like one of my main research topics since my PhD. I did my dissertation in 2012, and after that I went to University of Rochester, where there was this motivation research group, and I was part of that group for 1.5 years. And since then I have been like studying mainly trying to like figure out what are the main elements or like basic elements of human motivation. And I've written like a couple of books of them on these topics. Unfortunately they're in Finnish, but there's like one book on this willpower, tahdonvoiman käyttö, ohje. Then there's one book on this inner motivation called Valonöörit, and then I've been also writing one book together with my colleague Karolina Jarenko on this inner motivation at work life. But I thought that I will start with like just giving like quick like overview what is kind of like my approach to these topics of inner motivation and good life more generally. And if you think about art of living, like what is it like to live a good life, I think there's like two basic dimensions in this art of living. First, there's this like dimension of life management, which means that how well are you able to achieve those goals that you have put to yourself? That if you have some goal in life, are you able to achieve that goal, or are you not able to achieve that goal? Some people have like better like these management skills in their life, so they're able to like make sure that they get what they want. And other people like more easily get like things like just slide in a direction that they actually don't want it to slide, but they just cannot help it happening. So people can have like better or worse life management skills. But then there's this other dimension of art of living, which is like as important, but like perhaps something that is not taught so, like discussed so often, which is this life valuing dimension, which means that like that when you, at what are the goals worth striving for? That okay, people can strive towards different goals, but like not all goals are like as worthy of striving for as other goals. So one can like ask how much your life values, the values in your life and your goals in your life are something that you have like chosen yourself, something that you personally endorse, or how much they are just like passive result of just doing what you're told that you should be doing. So based on the two dimensions, we can like say that people like can like fall in one of these four squares, and in this right bottom corner, we can find people who are like good in life management, but perhaps like not so much have like thought about this life valuing, what are the goals that they want to strive in life. So this kind of like person is kind of this empty achiever, somebody who like achieves very many things, gets what he wants or she wants, but still at some point in life might like realize that all my efforts have been like in vain. What is this thing that I have achieved? That person like the person is 60 years old and living in some big mansion and realizes that he or she hasn't been present to his or her kids at all. So this empty achiever is like one way of living your life, which is not perfect, like the optimal way of living that life. And the opposite of this empty achiever is the person who is like in this upper left corner, who has very, very like endorsed like very good life values, is like endorsing good things in life, but at the same time is like quite bad at managing one's own life and thus is not able to achieve those goals one has like set for oneself. So we could call this person an ineffectual hippie. So it's kind of like this person like who has like this goal in life that, you know, I want to like make sure that the world peace is my goal in life. I want to like fight for world peace. And the way that the person is like fighting for world peace is staying at home and playing the guitar, which might not like then have so big effect on the peace in the world. And of course then the worst situation if one is in this like bottom left corner in life, that's not so good situation. But then for a long time I was thinking, what would be like label for this person in this upper right corner? What would we call a person who both has like a good this life management skills and good life valuing, like this authentic life valuing and self-endorsed values in life? And finally, I played around with like different words, but finally I was listening to this person who is Jane Dutton, who is this professor of business at University of Michigan. And she was introducing to the stage another professor, this Barbara Fredrickson. And Jane Datto, when she was introducing Barbara Fredrickson, she used the term light near. She said that Barbara Fredrickson, she is light near. And I immediately picked up this term because I liked it very much, this term light near, because it seems to combine these two things, that there's like this light, it starts with light, a light like means that you have like these beautiful values in light, life that are like shining a light around you and for yourself, while this near in the end of this word refers to engineer. And as we know, engineers are those people that when you have a goal, they are the people who like optimize the way towards that goal. So that's why I took this. That's why I took this light near as the label for this person who has like both these good life management skills and good these life valuing things. And I guess like what I strive to do through my research and through my books and other writings and speeches is help people to go to become more of light nears. Like help people to become light nears is what I try to do with my research and my other activities. And as I said, like it has like these two parts that like one can like try either try to like increase people's this life management skills, or one then one can like help people to find more authentic values to their lives. And I think like this speech I will like offer a bit of advice in both of these dimensions. I will start with like this life valuing dimension to get like some sense of what will be the values striving for, we're striving for, and then at the end of the lecture we go more towards the life management skills and willpower. How can like one increase one willpower in order to achieve what one wants to achieve? But before going more deeply into these themes, let's start with you and ask one question from you. And the question is, what motivates you in your own work, or if you're a student, what motivates you in your own studies? And let's do this so that let's take this so-called Kirsti Lonka method, because Kirsti Lonka is this professor in University of Helsinki, and she has this method that let's take this some basic question and think about that question 20 seconds in our own heads without discussing with anybody, just like intensive thinking in your own head for 20 seconds, and after that then discuss the question with the person next to you for few minutes. I take the timer so we can get the exact time for this 20 seconds of intensive thinking. So if you're ready, 20 seconds of intensive thinking on the topic, what motivates you in your own work or in your own studies? And the time starts now. Okay, and 20 seconds was there. So then if you can like take the person next to you and discuss for a few minutes, what are the things that motivate you in your work or in your studies? Okay, I think 2 minutes is up. Does somebody want to share like just quickly like what were the themes that you were discussing? You can just like shout it out.
To learn something new.
To learn something new. Bring value to somebody.
Achievable goals.
Achievable goals.
Clarity.
Sorry?
Clarity.
Clarity.
The sense that I'm working without a good conscience.
Yeah, so not anything disturbing too much to work in flow.
Connecting people.
Connecting people. Other people value what you do.
Sometimes fear of something worse.
Fear of something worse, okay. Mm. To create something new.
Make your colleague happy.
Make your colleague happy.
Free expression.
Free expression. Trust. Okay, but this is a question I'd be like asking like from quite many like different audiences. Like I'd be like asking this from like these flight stewards on Finnair. I'd be asking this question from like some engineers working in a chemical factory. I'd be asking this question from doctors. I'd be asking this question from some volunteering workers in this Red Cross and so forth. So like very, very many different like kind of like occupations, and I noticed that That it doesn't like matter how much, like what is the occupation of people. It's like the same teams that always like come up when one asks this question. That one team that comes up is that is like this able to express oneself free, able to do things that one feels that is are part of like one's self-expression. One team that comes up is this having like challenges, but being able to achieve something, being able to do something concrete. One team is then about these other people, that people being able to work together with some great colleagues or be able to meet great people through one's work. And then the fourth team that emerges is about this being able to contribute towards something, like towards the colleagues or to something larger in life. And these are quite much the four basic psychological needs that I will talk quite soon about. But before going into that, I might like say a few words about why I think this like this topic of self-motivation is especially important in today's world. And it has to do with the thing that the times, they are changing. As has been like said by Bob Dylan in the 60s. And this picture is from this movie Nummisuutarit by Alexis, or which is like based on this novel by Alexis Kivi, which pictures this like Finnish rural society in the 19th century. And the thing is that like when we switch from this rural agricultural society into this industrial society, the way we thought about work changed quite dramatically. That if you think about back to this like agricultural world, there wasn't like much difference between work and like work and other dimensions of life. You were working with the same people you were like otherwise hanging with. You were working in the same place where you were living, and there usually wasn't even like any salary involved, but basically you just got like some food and other materials for your efforts. So only through when we entered the Industrial Revolution, we got like this modern idea of work as something which is separate from home, something where you go to for a certain amount of hours, after which your like leisure time starts, and for which you get like some certain hourly based compensation. And now the thing is that we are like moving away from this industrial era towards this like this post-industrial era. More less and less people are working in this industrial work services, and more people are working in service sectors and other occupations. But still, quite much the way of we think about the world work and how we like organize the work is still like coming from this old paradigm, which needs to be changed. And I think that this change in the work life is like even today even more like urgent than it has been like for a long time, because nowadays, because there are like these like quite big changes, which, as one research was saying, that these changes that are happening in today's work life, they are caused by God. And with God, she meant globalization, automatization, and digitalization. So these three like big trends, this globalization, automatization, and digitalization, are changing the work life. And these Oxford University researchers were like making these calculations quite recently about this impact of automatization to the work life. And they were calculating that 1/3 of the current occupations are disappearing in the next 20 years in the half of the occupations in the United States are disappearing in the next 20 years because of automatization. And at the same time, this ETLA, which is like this Finnish Research Institute, they made the same calculations as regards Finland. And they got a bit more optimistic numbers that only 30% of the work in Finland is disappearing in the next 20 years because of the automatization, or 35%. And what kind of occupations are disappearing then? Like before, in the industrial era, the work that was disappearing was like regarded much connected to this physical effort, that like different occupations that had like where physical effort was like part of the occupation were like displaced by different machines which could do the work faster and more efficiently. But nowadays the thing is that because like with this automatization, we are also like replacing more and more thinking work which doesn't like infer any physical component, but where the human beings like thinking about something. For example, in the US, there's like much less lawyers, like much less entry-level jobs for lawyers available nowadays than it was like a few years ago. And the reason is that like this, there are nowadays these different softwares which are able to do many of the works that these entry-level lawyers were doing. So like usually in the lawyer firm, you had like some case, and the senior people were working on the case, and then the junior people like were assisting them by, for example, like going through these law books, trying to find like some previous case, similar cases from the law books and so forth. But this work, like going through these law books, trying to find like these cases, this is now done more efficiently by different algorithms and different softwares, which means that there's like much less work for like this like entry-level work available for lawyers. And it happened in other occupations as well. For example, this radiologist who look at the X-ray pictures, there's much less work like available for them nowadays because they're like this algorithm which go through these X-ray pictures and make like as good diagnoses as human beings, and it's sometimes even like better, like more accurate diagnosis than human beings from these X-ray big pictures. So if previously a big hospital needed 20 X-ray doctors, nowadays they might only need one who just goes through these automatic diagnoses and then like just like push the button that okay, accept the diagnosis that the machine has already done. So like many occupations are like disappearing in the future. And if one wants to like have an occupation which is like safe from this disappearing, there are basically like two components that an occupation should have in order to be like kind of like safe from this development. And so like all work that like involves routine work is kind of like in a danger, because like this routine work, both physical routine work and like this more thinking kind of routine work, can be like can be displaced by machines. But one thing that cannot be like, at least at the moment, like the machines are not good at, is this abstract thinking and like this like expertise in some field, you know, like really digging deep into the questions of the within one field and trying to make these expertise decisions in that field. So that so that's like one thing that is kind of like still done by humans in 20 years' time, at least hopefully, if we don't get this singularity or something like that happening. But anyway, like so, like this is like this abstract thinking, which means that you know that if your job is like to answer a question, that's like easier replaced by a machine. But if your job is to like think about what would be the relevant question, that is something that the machines can't be done. So machines can like answer questions that if somebody puts like very rigorous question, then the machine, one can build a machine who can answer the question. But the much harder part is like to think about what are the relevant questions in my field, what are the relevant questions to be asked, and this is something that these artificial intelligences are not good at the moment. And then the other thing that is like kind of like important in future work life is this human contact, because this is again something that cannot be replaced by machines. That if one's work involves like contact with other human beings, then like this contact part of the work might be like become more and more important. For example, as regards doctors, it's said nowadays that you know that before the good doctor was the person who was like able to make this accurate diagnosis. But nowadays, because we have like these softwares that assist the doctors making these diagnoses, then like the difference between a good and bad doctor as regards making like accurate diagnosis is getting smaller and smaller, because even the like bad doctors can have like the software which assists them in making the good diagnosis. So like in the future, the difference between a good and a bad doctor might not be like so much about this diagnosis, but more about how they communicate the diagnosis with the patients. What is their way of communicating and connecting with the patient in the situation? So like this like shift towards human contact and the importance of human contact in different occupations is like it's something that is going to be growing in the future. And then when one thinks about these two things, that is abstract thinking or human contact, one particular thing to notice is that like in these kind of occupations and these kind of like tasks, it's like it's much more important how you feel when you are working than in some like routine work, because like how productive thought or how like innovative thoughts you can like come up with, how good thinking you are able to come up with, it's quite much about like how you feel when you are working. What is your energy level when you are working? And which is like not so important in some routine work. So like if I think about myself, when I was like, I was in this moving company for like when I was studying, a couple of summers I was working in this moving company where we're like moving furniture from one building to another. And if I think about myself, like my productivity in the morning and my productivity in the afternoon, there might be like some difference in my productivity, you know, that in the afternoon I'm a bit more tired, I might not be able to lift the chairs and tables as fast as I was doing in the morning. So there might be like, you know, let's say like 30% difference in my productivity, that I'm 30% less productive in the afternoon. So that was routine work. But nowadays, when I'm a researcher, like then my like the main thing that I do during the race is like kind of like writing articles, like some scientific articles. And if I think about my productivity in the morning and my afternoon, in afternoon as regards to scientific articles, I can say that my that if I work from 9 to 11 in the morning, as compared to working from 2 to 4 in the afternoon, I think I can like achieve at least three times more text. Like just the length of the text is at least three times longer. And also the quality of the text is better. So like my productivity difference is like at least 300% and even probably even more. So when I think about like how I arrange my work days, it's not so much about like how many hours I'm working. It's more about like how I arrange the work days so that like when my energy levels and my like feelings are best, I'm able to do the work that like is most challenging. So like this Barry Schwartz was like referring to this shift in how we think about work with this slogan that manage your energy, not your time. That's how we like should think about our work life nowadays. That how are we managing our energy levels in order to be sure that when we need the most energy levels, when we have the most challenging tasks, the tasks where we need most creativity and more like most new ways of thinking, then we have the best energy levels. And that's something that one should like really think about, how to make sure that one is able to have these good energy levels and good feelings and good spirit when one is working in one's work. And the same goes also for this work with the human beings, that like if you think about like the quality of a service experience in different occupations or like different like services, then like one can really see if the like worker you are like who is serving you, is that worker like kind of like excited about his or her work, or is the worker just like, you know, hanging there just for the money? And like that has a difference for like how I experience a service, which has a different than like what is the quality of the service level. So which means that in both of these occupations, both occupations which like involve this abstract thinking and the occupations that involve human contact, we should be very aware of how are we feeling during the workday. And in order to understand that more, how are we feeling during the workday, we need to know more about the human feelings. And if you think about human feelings, we usually like make a distinction that some feelings are good and some feelings are bad, some feelings are positive, some feelings are negative. And that's one distinction that can be made as regards to feelings. But then there's also this other dimension, like if you look at the research on like human emotions, there's another dimension which is as important, but perhaps like something that is not talked about as often. And it's about these activation levels, like how activating certain emotion is. So for example, if you look at this like left part of this circle, like we could put like sadness into this lower left corner of this figure, because sadness is like a negative emotion, but it's also like this more passive emotion. If you have like a big sadness that you go through, you probably do less things that you would do otherwise. And then on the other hand, anger would be like up there in this upper left corner, because anger is an emotion that is not only negative but also like very active. It makes you do things. It might not make you do things that you're like you want to be doing or like you think that were good things to be done, but it still like makes you do things. So there's like a quite big difference like as regards like activation levels between sadness and anger. And if you think about the working life, one of them is in Finnish, but anyways, in the working life, there's like we can like say that there's like four basic types of emotions you can have like during your working day. One is this sense of engagement, which is like this positive and high activation feeling as regards your work, that you're really excited about what you're working with. Another one is this work satisfaction. And satisfaction is that more this like this positive feeling, but more this low activation feeling, that you might be satisfied with the conditions of your work, but you might not be like so excited about the work itself. So like, and nowadays when we measure like the working life, we quite often measure like this satisfaction of employees. And I've been thinking that it's not like the best like indicator that like should be measured, that at least it should be like combined with measuring also people's engagement at work. Because if we can think about, for example, a worker who's like kind of like this king of the coffee machine, that the work he comes to work in the morning, and then he goes next to this coffee machine and drinks coffee there, and like hangs with people and chats with people. And then one goes and asks, like, so how satisfied are you with your work? And the person is like, yeah, we got this new coffee machine just recently. It has very decent espresso. So I would say that my satisfaction is 9. Then we go to the next person, asked about the person, like, how satisfied are you with your work life? And the person says that, we have this like new project that's like just started. I think the goals are quite high, but I think we have a very good team around it. I'm quite excited to work on this thing, and I think we can manage to achieve our goals in the next couple of months. So I would say that my satisfaction levels are also at 9. So then we will have like these two persons who both like see that their satisfaction levels are at 9, but one is mainly satisfied about the coffee machine and the other is mainly excited about the work itself. So there might be like some difference in these two workers still that is not captured by this measurement of satisfaction. That's why we should like measure also this engagement. And then if you think about the difference between the stress and engagement, we can say that both the stress and the engagement are things that are good ways of getting things done. That like if you have like some deadline which is approaching, it's a good way of motivating oneself to get doing things. And if people experience like the short-term stress, that people sometimes experience stress in their life, that's usually like there's nothing bad with that. It's good that people sometimes have like stress levels high in their life. But if this stress becomes chronic, if a person is like experiencing stress every day in their work life, if they go through every work day just through the stress, stressing about different things, that's usually not so good for people. That like that starts like kind of like have a bad effect on both their like physical health and their mental health, and like might end up in like some more serious symptoms like burnout or something like that. So even though short-term stress might be like okay thing to have, then long-term stress, being always stressed about one's work, is not anything that is like very good about work life. So like it's much better to have like, if I want to like achieve things in the work, do this through this engagement instead of like just stress. That's much more like healthier way of getting things done in the work life than just through stress. And we actually, with my colleague Karolina Jarenko, we did like we went through this literature on this topic of this work engagement and what are the research on work engagement and different variables. And we found out like two things that like I will not go like through these like researches like one by one, but like just two things that worth noting from here, this list was that first, like people who are more engaged about their work are also more productive. They get more things done. And this has been like measured in several ways in several different research studies. And the reason that people get more done when they're engaged is one reason is that they're more proactive in their working life. They're more taking like responsibility for their own work experience and what they're achieving in life. So if people are not engaged, they might like just do the things that they're asked to do. But if you're like really engaged about your work, you're actively thinking of what should be done, what are the good things that should be like achieved in this work. And people who are like engaged are also like more willing to learn new things. They're more willing to like experiment with new ideas. And that leads them also to be more creative and more innovative in their work. And also like as in like service occupations, like people who are more engaged, they're also like their service attitude as experienced by the customers is also better. So there are like many reasons why people, like why it's good for the employer that people are engaged at work. But then it's also very good for like the employees themselves to be like engaged at work. But there's also research about that people who are engaged, they are more happy, they are less depressed, they are less cynical in life. And also their like physical health is better, that they have like they rate their own health better, they have like less different symptoms, and they also like have like less sickness absenteeism if they're like more engaged as regards their work. And finally, this engagement also like carries over to one's spare time or like leisure time. And it has been found out that those people who are more engaged at work, they also rate their family life as better, and they also have like better sleep quality. And that might be related to the stress dimension, that if you're very stressed throughout your work day, then you go home, you're like totally, you have given everything from yourself, so like then you're not able to like interact with your family anymore because you're just hanging there in the sofa and not having any energy left to do anything. But if you go through your work day with this engagement, which is like in a way less demanding, Because if you work, if you go through work life with the distress, then you always have like to push yourself to do things. You're always pushing yourself to do things, which is like quite, which is quite straining. But if you go through the work life with this engagement, you don't have to push yourself to do things because these things are kind of like pulling you towards them. You want to do the things because you're excited about them, which means that you're like at the end of the workday, you're less. You have like more energy left also to do things on your leisure time and, for example, interact with the family. So in this sense, this sense of engagement is quite much this win-win situation. It's good for both like employer and it's good, and the productivity, but it's good for the employees themselves and their health and well-being. So the next question is then like how to achieve this sense of engagement at work. And I think here we need this concept of intrinsic and extrinsic motivation, this like inner motivation. There are basically two ways to motivate oneself to do things. One is this extrinsic motivation, which means that I might not be like so excited about the thing to be done itself, but I do it for some extrinsic reasons. There's some like some reward I get for doing it, or there's some punish that I avoid if I do it. So this is like kind of this carrot and stick motivation, this extrinsic motivation, that the thing itself might not be so motivated, but I do it because like I get something external, some reward or avoid some punishment. And if you think about the working life, there are always certain these extrinsic motivation elements involved. For example, that if you do your work, you usually get some salary. And if you don't do your work, then like somebody might be coming to say to you that, why are you not doing your work? So like the working life involves these extrinsic elements of motivation like by default. But then there's this other way of motivating oneself, which is like this intrinsic motivation, which is more about the thing that you feel that there's something within the working life, something within the work itself, that the tasks themselves are somehow like exciting or interesting or valuable. And that means that you want to do the things just for the reason of doing the things, that you don't need any like extrinsic rewards or extrinsic punishment to be able to be wanting to do the things, but you just want to do the things for their own sake. So if you think about some kids, like if I have like four-year-old kid at home, if when he comes home from the daycare and he goes to his own room, he's like kind of starts to play with the Legos, and I don't have to like punish him to like be able to make him play with the Legos. I don't have to like reward him to make him play well with the Legos. But like Legos are just like pulling him towards themselves. So like he's kind of like, he has like quite high intrinsic motivation to play with the Legos. So like there's like no reason for me to like go interfere with some like punishments or rewards to make him play with the Legos. But then if you think about the working life, there's also this intrinsic motivation involved in working life as well. That there's always at least some tasks within the working day which are like more exciting, more interesting to be done. So like as regards working life, it's not about like this like that we should have either extrinsic motivation or intrinsic motivation, but it's more about that we have to accept that the extrinsic motivation is always there, and then we have to like just think about how could we like increase also the intrinsic motivation to make sure that we are not working just for the money, but there's also some like intrinsic rewards to be gained from the working experience. Now that we anyways are spending like quite many of our hours in the day in the workplace, it would be like good to have like some excitement happening also in that area of life. And how then to like find this intrinsic motivation as regards one working life? In order to answer that question, then we have to go into these four basic elements of, or four psychological needs that humans have. And for that we need to like look at this picture. And the basic idea of this picture is that there's like that on an even deeper level, if I think about human motivation and why we do things instead of just passively hanging in one corner, then we have to like there are like two of these existential basic questions that like are that answer why people do things in their life. And this first basic existential question is about how to stay alive. So survival is something that motivates human beings as well as other animals, that we are like quite hardwired to make sure that we like survive. That if this is like, if our survival is at stake, we are willing to do almost anything to make sure that we are like kind of like not dying. And that means that one part of our motivation is this safety and resources, that we want to make sure that we have like enough resources to be like safe and like kind of like have we have the some house that we can live in. We don't have to live on the street. We have like some food today. We have some food tomorrow. So this basic safety is something that motivates human beings quite much, and we have to make sure that like we want to make sure that like we have this basic safety in our life. And that's like okay, that's quite self-evident. But then there's like this other element of this how to stay alive, which is connected to other people. Because if we think about human species, we are really this social kind of animal with, who lives in these tribes, which means that like if you go back to the savannah where human beings were living a couple of millions of years ago, then this, if the tribe was like abandoning you, that meant that your survival rate like dropped quite much, that your chance of surviving the next couple of years would be like much lower if you were kind of like if you didn't have the tribe around you anymore. And that means that we are like also very much hardwired to seek acceptance from other people, to make sure that other people accept us and at least are not abandoning us. So that's like something that is very deeply within our motivational system as well. And just like one funny story about this is this Stanley Milgram, who was this like famous psychologist in the 60s, he used to like take, when he has added some courses to the students, he used to give students different like tasks to be done. And one task that he gave to the students was that go to the metro, the subway, during the rush hour, and then like ask somebody like who is sitting there that, excuse me, can I sit in your place? That you're not allowed to like give any explanations, just go there and ask somebody that, can I sit in your place? Then 1 week later, when the next lecture came, it turned out that none of the students had done this task. All of them thought that it was like a bit too like kind of like hard to be done. And then the Stanley Milgram got a bit angry about that, and he decided that after the lecture, he will go himself to the subway to just like show people that it can be done. So then he went to the subway and was there like standing and started to look at the people, and he started to get a bit nervous himself as well. He started to be like, his palms started to be a bit sweaty. And he realized that it's not so easy to be done as he was thinking it would be. But then he thought that, okay, I'm Stanley Milgram, one of the most famous psychologists of my time. I, at least, can control my own mind. So then he took like some very, very nice-looking person and asked the person that very like carefully that, excuse me, can I sit in your place? And the person, of course, like stood up, and the Stanley Milgram sat in this person's place. But at the same moment that as he sat in this place, the situation got like so like he had like so much like anxiousness as regards the situation that it like it came out as like this physical pain that his stomach started to hurt quite much in the situation. So like in the end he was not sitting in the chair straight, but he was actually sitting in this chair like this, you know, holding his own stomach there. So kind of like his body was making sure that like suddenly he was like so ill that actually he needed the chair that he was like asking. And Stanley Milgram, he got like so excited about this situation that he decided he wants to do like some research study on the topic. So then he hired some research assistants like to do the same thing, go to the subway in the rush hour and ask people like, excuse me, can I sit in your place? Okay, this turned out to be like this one of these classical psychological studies, and it meant, and accordingly then like some 40 years later, New York Times was wanting to like interview these people who were involved in this research. So they were like asking these research assistants, who now were like themselves some 60-year-old professors, about this like this research study that they had been doing in their 20s. And these research assistants said that like even now it was still one of the most like kind of embarrassing moments in their life had been that moment in their 20s when they had like asked few strangers in the subway, can they sit in their place? So they still like 40 years afterwards, they still vividly remembered like how embarrassing and hard it was to do this thing. And if you think about this situation, you know, somebody has to stand up for a couple of subway stops. Like nobody's dying, nothing like dramatic is happening. But it's very hard for our human beings like to break the social norms without any good explanation or without any good reason. That the social norms are like quite much governing our lives. We do many things in order to like, kind of like be accepted by the community around us. And this community around us can be like, it can be like the strangers in a subway train, or it can be like, you know, our parents, it can be our friends in the childhood, it can be our student friends, it can be our colleagues, it can be our neighbors, it can be the society at large. But still, we have to remember that quite much things in life we are doing in order to be accepted by other people and not be abandoned by other people. So we like, want to be like accepted by other people and not be abandoned by other people. And that explains quite many of our actions in life. But the problem with these two things, this acceptance and safety, is that they are both of these like these more these extrinsic elements of motivation. You know, that I'm not doing this thing for it the thing itself, but I'm doing it in order to gain some acceptance from other people or in order to gain some resources that increase my safety. So as regards well-being, we nowadays know that not having these things is connected to ill-being. That, you know, if you feel that you're like ostracized from the people around you, then you really usually that's like a dramatic effect on your well-being. That you don't feel usually very well, and like this feeling of being ostracized can be like as painful as being like this physical pain. So like if you're lacking these basic resources for like living, that if you're like lacking food or basic safety, that is like that has like quite big negative effect on our well-being. But still, like, if we have these things in life, that, you know, if we have this basic safety around, that we have like, you know, basic safety things, and we have like people around us are accepting us, that doesn't mean that we are like having well-being still. That it only can explain why we don't have ill-being. But like, so we can get from the negative level to this level zero. But if you want to want to understand what makes possible human well-being, like this getting from this level zero to like this having like this positive well-being, then we have to ask this other existential basic question. And that's a question of what makes life worth living. That now that we are staying alive, what makes our life worth living? And in order to answer that question, then we get to these four basic elements of human motivation, these four basic needs, which can like explain quite much of our intrinsic motivation, but also about like our well-being and our sense of meaningfulness in life. And first of these four elements is the sense of autonomy, which means that I feel volitional in my life. I feel that like the things that I'm doing in life are something that I've been able to choose myself. They are not like something that are kind of like forced upon me from like some like somebody else. And as regards this autonomy, I remember like when I said I was in this University of Rochester for like 1.5 years. And during that time, me and my family took like these car drives in the nearby states. This Rochester is in the New York State, so like we were like making these like car drives in the weekends, like some nearby states. And in US, in these register plates of like different cars, there's always this like this slogan of the state. So in New York, in every car plate, there was this like slogan, Empire State. Then when you went to New Jersey, into every car, there was like this slogan, Garden State. In Florida, it's Sunny State, and so forth. But then at one point, we ended up in this New Hampshire, which is this small state in the northeast corner of US with like I think like some 1.5 million people, so quite small state. And in New Hampshire, in every car register plate, there was this slogan, live free or die. So if you think about it, it's a bit like on a different level, that if one car says that Garden State and the other car says that live free or die, there's some difference in these like kind of like the messages of these cars. So of course when I saw this cars, I had to like go to the Wikipedia to like find out why do the cars have this like this sign, the register plate. And it turned out that it was like when the US was like fighting for its independence from like this British rule in the 18th century, then there was this general John Stark, who was from New Hampshire and who had like an important part in this independence war. And that was his slogan, this live free or die. There are things more important in life than living. That was kind of like his slogan. But like it also turned out that the same slogan has been like used like quite many other people around the world. Like when Uruguay wanted to get the independence from Spanish Empire, they also had this slogan "Liberte o muerte," which is translated "freedom or death." And when Greece people wanted to get their independence from this Ottoman Empire, they had the same slogan. When Ukraine wanted to get their independence, they had the same slogan, and so forth. So it turned out like that, if you think about like what makes life worth living, It turns out that millions of people throughout the history have thought that, okay, my life is lacking freedom and this autonomy, so I'm willing to fight for this freedom, and even until their death. And millions of people has also died in this fight for freedom. Now, if you turn to work life, I think like the things are usually not so dramatic. It's not about like life or death, usually, this sense of autonomy. But in the work life, this sense of autonomy basically means two things. That one thing is that like one feels that the goals that one has in one's work life are something that one wants to achieve. That it's not something that, you know, are like forced upon oneself from somebody else, but one feels that, you know, that the mission of this organization or the mission of my occupation in this organization is something that I feel that I want to like kind of be part of. I feel that this is something I want to kind of like be connected to, that something that is like kind of like, it's not about like just other people, it's also about like me, myself feeling that this is something that I want to be part of and connected to. So this like kind of this goal autonomy is the first part of this like autonomy in work life, that one feels that the goals are something that one is like kind of like committed to, something that one chooses for one wants to choose for oneself. And then the other is like other part of this autonomy in the work life is then this task autonomy. Like when one has these goals, how freely one is able to like kind of like strive towards these goals, like find the ways, means to strive towards the goals, and how much one feels that somebody's kind of like always behind one's back and like micromanaging oneself. So I guess like this micromanaging, like being always like kind of like trying to control people is like one of the best ways to like kind of like decrease people's intrinsic motivation and people's sense of autonomy in the work life. So that's what this autonomy means in the work life, the feeling that you have, the goals you have in the work life are something that you're like willing to commit towards, and also that feeling that you're able to like go towards these goals in a way that is kind of like you have chosen yourself. But in addition to this autonomy, there's another basic need, which is called competence, which is about this human need to achieve things, get things done, and also be like feel that, you know, one is talented, and one has the skills necessary to accomplish what one wants to accomplish. So it means like this, like feeling talented and skillful in one task. It means this sense of accomplishment, getting things done. And thirdly, it means also the sense of like learning and growth, because learning and growth means that one's competence is increasing. And if you have like these two things in your life, if you have that you have feel that you have like autonomy in your life and you feel that you have competence in your life, then you can like feel that you are kind of like able to express yourself. The self-expression is quite much about like feeling autonomous and competent, that finding some goals that you feel are worth striving towards, and also feeling that you're like able to strive towards this goal, that you have the necessary skills to strive towards these goals. If you have these two elements present in your life or within your work, then you feel that you're like able to express yourself. But competence, in addition to being one part of this like self-expression, it's also like an like important source of motivation and well-being by itself. And just as a personal story about this competence is that when I never been like much of a like food maker or a cook. I never liked too much like cooking. And I never, that means that also I never liked too much like going to the grocery store. But then like 4 years ago, then when the first kid was born into our family, it meant that we had to start this weekly trip to the Prisma grocery store. And it was not the highlight of my week at all. It was actually quite frustrating going into the Prisma because like one reason was that like my skill levels as regards Prisma were like quite low. So when we went there, then I had this like very long list of items that we need to get from there. And then I looked at the items that there was like item called, for example, like some eggplant. Then I thought, okay, how does eggplant look like? And I didn't have like very like exact idea of that. So it was like then I knew that it's a vegetable, but that was all. So then I had to like go through this like this vegetable section, like, you know, read all the signs from there, like, you know, is this an eggplant? No. Is this an eggplant? No. Is this an eggplant? And then finally I find the eggplant from somewhere there. And then there's the next, or the item list is, for example, like some broccoli or something like that. And again I'm thinking, how does a broccoli look like? At one point I realized that I could use this, like my phone's, this Google image search for this purpose. So then I put this broccoli in this image search, then I get the picture of broccoli, and that helped like find where the broccoli is located, because then I could like compare it, this picture, like these things that I saw in this vegetable section. But it was still like quite a slow process. And then there were like some other things in the list, like for example, pesto or something like that. And I know how pesto looks like, but like if you think about the Prisma and how like long the shelves are there, I didn't have like no clue where pesto is located in what of the shelves the pesto is located. So then I had to like go through these like kilometer long shelves like one by one and try to find where is the pesto located. So it was like, it took like quite a long time, and it was very frustrating, this Prisma thing. So like both my like well-being and motivation were quite low during this Prisma visits. But the thing is that now that my this firstborn son is like now 4.5 years old, it means that we have been going to the same Prisma, this Prisma in Viikki, for 4 years. And it means that also that my competence as a Prisma goer has gone up quite much. So nowadays I know where the eggplants are, I know where the like pestos are located. So like it means that like when I have the list, I look at the items, I said, that item, I know where that is located, I take it, then I take the next item, then I take the next item. And like this experience of flow during the Prisma take is like perhaps is much higher. So I think like, you know, just because like my competence as a Prisma goer has gone up, also my motivation to go to the Prisma and my well-being during these Prisma trips have gone up quite much. And that's kind of like, in a way, like quite natural that we like to do things that we are good at, and we get frustrated if there are things that we are not good at. So this sense of competence is important, but it's also like important to like that if we want to experience this sense of competence, it's important that we have like tasks that the skill level of our own skill level and like the challenge level of the task is like kind of like somehow in harmony. That people don't like doing things that which are like too hard for them. You know, if you have like very low skill level and like hard tasks like going to the Prisma, then it's like very 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 frustrating. But on the other hand, if I am very talented at something and I have like a high skill level at some task, and I feel that, you know, that the task itself is like not challenging enough, that leads quite often to like quite quickly to boredom. Like when people get bored when the challenges are not like up to their like skill level. So like in order to experience this like this sense of competence and sense of flow in one activities, one needs to have like this harmony between the skill level and the challenge level. That the challenges have to match the skills. Like too much skills is not good, or too much skills as compared to the challenges is not good, because then one gets bored. But like too much challenges as compared to the skills is not good either, because then one gets like this anxious and frustrated. Okay, but that's like this self-expression, this autonomy and competence. But in addition to these two elements which are connected to the self-expression and to myself, there are also two elements of this intrinsic motivation which are more connected to other people. And first of these elements is the sense of relatedness, which means the sense of like, kind of like not only that people are accepting me, but there's also like some deep connection between me and some other person. That there are people who see me as I am, and there's like some kind of deep connection that I'm caring about you and you're caring about me. So we need these kind of feelings in our life in general, and also within our working life. And as regards working life, I remember when I was doing my dissertation, I did it in a nursing home. I was interviewing the nurses in a nursing home. And one question I was asking from the nurses was that describe me sometime in your working life when you felt the worst. What has been like the most like kind of challenging time during your working life? And interesting enough, these nurses were answering this question, they almost never talked about the work itself. The thing that they were talking about was like about the colleagues and their supervisors at that point. So the moments in their working life when they felt the worst were not about like kind of like their not about the task itself, but more about their colleagues. That when they had like some problems with some colleagues or when they had some problems with their supervisor, that was the moment when they felt like the worst in their work. But on the other hand, it also turned out that many of these nurses, when the community in their work was like working well, when there was like some like good relatedness within the work community, then it was like an important source of their well-being, that they also felt that, you know, even in days when their work itself was very like challenging, or even if they had like some issues going on at home, they felt that like if the work community was good and like supportive, that support that they got from the working community was buffering quite much like kind of this negative effects of these like more challenging tasks, that like so that the working life, the community was like quite important source of well-being and also like important source of important kind of like support network that helped them to manage through like the tougher days. So in both good and bad, if the working community is working well and people feel that there's like the sense of relatedness between people, it has a very important role in their well-being. And if it doesn't have this sense of community, it can have like important role in their ill-being. So it's like this work community is like quite important source of this like sense of well-being and engagement at work. And then the fourth and the last element is about the feeling that, you know, in addition that we want to feel that there are people who care about me and whom I care about, we also want to feel that, you know, we are able to make some kind of contribution towards these people we care about. So the sense of benevolence is the fourth basic need. So it's about this feeling that I'm able to make a positive impact in the life of other people. And these other people, they can be like either like my colleagues, you know, that I'm like kind of making my colleagues happy during my working day. They can be my customers, like the end users of the product that we are like making, that I feel that, you know, through our work we make this product and this product improves people's lives. Or it can be like even some like broader societal impact that through our work or through my activities we are able to make some big positive societal impact. And this is also like an element that can like motivate people quite much. For example, this professor Adam Grant from Wharton University, he had this nice research where he has taken this university donation call center people, because in US the universities, like quite a big part of their like money that university has comes from these donations made by these alumni, these former university students. So like the alumni are usually like, many of the alumni are donating quite big amounts of money to the university. Which means that there's like this occupation where you're this like person whose task is like to call these alumni. So you call the alumni and say, hello from the university. You graduated from this university 30 years ago. What would you say? Would you like to put, for example, $30,000 to the university account? So you make these kind of calls every day. So that's occupation that some of these students were like doing. And if some of you have like done this call center kind of job in your life, you might like know that it's not usually the most motivating work that there is. That many people who are working in these kind of occupations, they don't get like too much like motivation from it, that they merely do it just for the money. And many of them like switch to another job immediately when they get some better job anywhere else. But Adam Grant decided to do this kind of like intervention, that he took these people, these fundraisers, and he connected them with like one of these like graduate students from this university. So one student of biology who was like doing his dissertation in biology came to these fundraisers and just stayed there for like for 5 minutes and said to these people that, hello, I'm this and this student of biology. I'm doing my dissertation on this and this topic. I think my topic is very important for these and these reasons. Thanks for collecting this money. It makes possible my work and other people like me. So for 5 minutes, these fundraisers, they met somebody who is actually benefiting from their work. And after that, this Adam Grant was measuring these people's like output the next month. And it turned out that these people who met this person for 5 minutes, in the next month, they spent like twice as many minutes on the phone. So like the phone line was open twice as long as for other people. And also they collected 2.5 times more money for the university. So just by meeting somebody who benefits from your work for 5 minutes was able to like increase their contribution to the fundraising by more than two times, which is like quite like strong increase in the motivation by like such short intervention. So like that means that like one way to find motivation in the work is like try to like find out how to like connect the work to the person who is like actually benefiting from the work. So in like some occupations, it's like more like kind of like the person who is like benefiting once from one works is like closer by. You know, if one is like some nurse, some person in the nursing occupation, for example, they are always like meeting face to face with the people who are like actually benefiting from their work. So they're like this sense of benevolence might be like quite like easy to see. But if somebody is working, for example, in some factory, producing like some machines in the factory, it might be that you never actually meet the people who actually use the products that you are producing. And like the distance between yourself and the person who is like benefiting from your work might be like much longer. And then it's like harder to see harder to make it visible this connection that who is actually benefiting from your work. And for example, this company John Deere, who is making these tractors, that company like decided that they want to do something about this thing, and they did so that like when somebody buys a tractor from this John Deere, then they invite the buyer to this ceremony where like the tractor is actually the keys of the tractor are given to the person who buys the tractor. And but they decided to do it so that instead of if I'm the seller who like sold the tractor, I'm not the one who's like giving over the keys to this person buying the tractor, but instead of like a person from this factory, one engineer from the factory is like brought specifically to this situation just in order that the person can like give the keys to this person who is buying the tractor. Because that was felt that that's a way of this connecting these engineers who do the like work with the tractors, to connect these engineers with the actual impact that they are making, that they are actually able to see this some person buying the tractor and like happily driving with the tractor to the sunset. Okay, but these are the four basic needs of human beings. There are four basic psychological needs. So this autonomy and competence, they are related to this self-expression, being able to express yourself, that if you experience autonomy and competence in life, you're able to express yourself. And then this relatedness and benevolence, they are more connected to other people. How are you able to connect with other people, either through being like caring about them and feeling this sense of connection, or then like being able to contribute something towards these other people. And as I said, these four elements already can explain quite a big part of our well-being and about our well-being, our intrinsic motivation, how motivated we are towards certain tasks, and also about our productivity and even our sense of meaningfulness as regards our work. So if we get these four elements right, we already are in a quite good situation as regards our working life. So then the basic question is how to increase these four elements. How to make sure that one has more sense of autonomy, competence, relatedness, and benevolence in one's working life. And of course, part of how to increase these elements is about what the employer is doing, what are the structures of the work, how it is work organized, and these kind of things. They have an impact on these four elements. But other element is also how one is related to the work oneself, what is one's own way of relating to the work. And that's something one can try to affect oneself. And I was thinking that in order to somehow try to connect these elements to one's own life, let's have this one small exercise for which we need everybody needs this one piece of paper. So the idea of this exercise, which is called vocational mapping, is this. It comes from this colleague Lauri Järvilehto, who was coming up with this exercise based on his own experiences. So when Lauri was 14, he was living in Oulu, in northern part of Finland, and when he was 14 years old boy, he decided that he wants to be a music producer when he grows up. That music producer is like the task that the occupation that he wants to be in when he is growing up. And Lauri was putting quite much effort into making sure that this thing happens. And it turned out that when he was 20, he was hired by one of these biggest music producing companies of Finland, which meant that when he was in his 20s, he was able to produce these top 10 hits in the top 10 Finnish hits. So many Finnish songs that he was able to produce. So he was able to do just the work that he wanted to do when he was 14. But the thing that Lauri didn't think about when he was 14 was that even though this music producer's job has all these this nice glamour around it. So like when you're a music producer, you're able to get like all these like cool parties and like girls are interested in you and so forth. So that was the good part of the job. But the thing that Lauri didn't realize when he wanted to be a music producer is that kind of the everyday reality of music producer is that you're actually like there in this studio. You're might be there like alone in the studio. There's this big mixer board, or at that time it was big mixer board. Nowadays I guess it's more computer based thing. But you had this big mixer board there, and then you like listen to the same song again and again and again, and then you like think that okay, it sounds good, but let's switch, put this switch slightly up and this switch slightly down. After that, then you listen to the song again and think that okay, it's slightly better, but we have to still adjust this a bit, and then we have to adjust this a bit. And then so you're alone there like for 10 hours in front of this big like mixer board, and the thing is that if you don't like that part of the work, then you don't like then you will not like the work. It's work at all, even though like other things in the work might be like as good as they are. And the problem was that Lauri was like that was not the part of the job that he liked the most, which meant that actually he then like got like this burnout as regards his job in the quite early in the 20s, and then he went to Paris for 1 year to search himself, and after that he started to study philosophy, and that's another story. But kind of like the point of the story is that like you don't become happy by what you have, but you become like happy by what you do every day. What are the activities that you do every day? And in this spirit, I was like, now that you have the paper in front of you, let's take like a couple of minutes, and your task is like to try to write as many different activities into the paper that you like doing just for the sake of the activity itself. So you know, think about like different activities within your working life, within your like other life as well. So like myself, I would put like into this kind of list, for example, playing football would be on my list, going to the sauna would be on my list. There would be like things like writing articles, reading books would be on my list. Trying to solve a task together with some colleagues would be on my list. So like try to like think about different activities, both within your working life and outside your working life, that like activities that you like doing just for the sake of the activities themselves. That what activities are like kind of like rewarding to yourself. So let's take a couple of minutes and try to fill the paper up with as many activities as possible. Okay. So then the next task, when you have like the list in front of you with these activities, is then like go through these activities and like put like number 1, 2, or 3 next to each activity. And number 3 means that the activity is something that you're able to do like currently in your life as much as you want to do, that you're able to do that activity as much as you want. Number 2 means that you're like able to do that activity somewhat, but like not as much as you would like to do that activity. And number 1 means that you're not able to do that activity basically at all in your life at the moment. So like number 3 means that you're able to do it as much as you want to do. 2 means that you're able to do it somewhat, but you would like to do it a bit more. And number 1 means that you're not able to do the activity at all currently. So put 1, 2, or 3 to every activity. And then when you have rated these items, then you can like, then we can take like a few minutes that you can discuss this list with your like kind of person sitting next to you. That you don't have to like, you don't have to reveal what you have like written on the list if there are like some embarrassing things that you have written on the list. You don't have to reveal all of them, but like just like share with the person next to you like what kind of feelings and like ideas you got like from like doing this exercise. Bob Dylan, the singer, was once asked, like, what does he think, what is success for him? And Bob Dylan answered that for him, success is that you wake up in the morning and you go to sleep at night, and in between you only do things that you enjoy doing. So that was like his definition of success. And in a way that this vocational mapping exercise is kind of like the idea is to try to bring people closer towards this, like this Bob Dylan's definition of success, because if you will be able to do only things on this list the whole day, then you will be like quite much doing, like quite much enjoying the success that Bob Dylan was like telling about. And this is like a kind of like, so the idea of this exercise is that I try to like kind of figure out what are the things that you, if you think about this sense of autonomy, what are the things that you enjoy doing just for their own sake, Because like if you would like, the more aware you are of these things, the more aware your like colleagues are of these things, the better you'll be like able to like do these things in the working life and in your life in more generally. So like kind of like these different activities can be like fulfilled. Some of these things can be like more things that, you know, people want to like fulfill in their leisure time, and some of them might be like things that you want to fulfill during their working time. But the thing is that how to get more of these things within one's working day is like one way of like make like increasing one's sense of autonomy and through that one's sense of intrinsic motivation toward the work. And one way to like try to bring more of these things into one's working day is like this through this job crafting, which means like kind of like this approach when one like when I start like consciously tries like somehow change one's job towards things that like kind of like are closer to one's intrinsic motivation. And there are basically like three ways like one can like craft one's job. That first thing is this so-called like task crafting, that one can like try to like craft what are the tasks one is doing within one's job working day. For example, there was this one bus driver featured in the newspapers, Finnish newspapers, like 1 year ago. And the bus driver like decided that his task is not only taking people from place A to place B, but his task is actually like delight people when they come aboard the bus. So the bus driver was like one thing was like, you know, that whenever people like stepped into the bus, he was like, you know, greeting them very like happily. He was also putting some music on the bus, and then he was putting these small signs hanging here and there with like some like nice slogans. So he decided like by himself, he didn't ask like any his supervisor or anything, but just by himself he decided that he will like can like craft his task. That it's not about like just like moving people, but it's also about delighting people. And that also really, so like one way is like crafting one's work is like trying to like craft the task that one is doing within one's working day. What are the tasks one wants to be doing? For example, if one puts on this like vocational mapping, like some tasks like arranging parties, some people like that, then one might try to like kind of like get into the committee who's like organizing the Christmas party of the workplace or something like that in order to be able to do that during the working time, be able to organize parties. So task crafting is one thing that one can like craft within one's job. Other thing is then like this like interaction crafting, like trying to like influence who one is interacting during the working day and who one is not interacting during the working day. Because like some interactions can be like more energy giving and some interaction can be like more energy draining. That some interactions might like drain oneself from energy, while some from some other interactions one can like get quite much energy. So like one thing then is like try to like figure out how to like make sure that one has more of these energy giving interactions instead of these energy draining interactions. For example, this bus driver, like I guess like because usually the bus drivers like quite often in here, like the interaction with them is like not so like vivid, but it's more like that, you know. Usually one's just like push the machine nowadays, but even if one like buys the ticket from the bus driver, then even in that kind of situations, usually the only interaction that the bus driver is like giving out is saying this thank you, but like which is in Finnish kiitos, but not saying kiitos, but saying tos. That's like kind of the usual interaction. So like kind of taking from that way of interacting with other people, this like more this delight to try to like make people's birthday happier. Interactions like might be like quite effective way of like crafting one's interactions during the working day. And then the third way of crafting one's job is like kind of like, that sometimes one can like so much influence the task one is having, but one thing one can like always influence is this kind of like this one's attitude towards one's work. What is like the attitude one has towards one's work? And one example is this Amy Resniewski, who's this professor who has been like studying this matter. She had this like example of that when she was like went to like some hospital to interview the janitors of the hospital, the people who like keep the hospital clean. Then she asked from one of these cleaners, so what is your job about? And the person said, yeah, my job is about like, you know, keep the floors clean. Then she went to the next person asking, so what is your job about? Then she said, my job is to be part of this bigger machinery which keeps people healthy. That I help people being healthy by keeping the hygiene levels up and by like interacting with the people like when I get in contact with them. So like both of these persons, like the actual job that the task that they were doing were the same, that they were like cleaning the floors, but one was feeling that one is just cleaning the floor, while the other felt that she is part of the bigger organization which is like keeping people healthy. And it's not like hard then to guess like which of these persons was more like engaged and more like engaged within the working days and found her work more meaningful. Like, because like this, so like this, just by changing one's attitude towards one work, one can also like achieve big things like as regards one's work. For example, like also like I mentioned this fundraiser of the university, that they just, even though like they were doing the same work, they were still like calling these like people asking for money for the university. But because of this intervention, their attitude towards their own work had changed. They had realized that actually, hey, through this work, I'm actually benefiting other people. And that had like, that made a big impact on their like kind of this work activities. Yeah, so these are the basically the three ways. One example actually I want to mention it as regards this attitude change, it was also what I experienced myself. Like a couple of years ago, like we needed an electrician at our home to make in the bathroom to put some lights up there. And like some, and then the electrician arrived and I was like there at home alone at the moment. And at the door already, the electrician said that, by the way, I'm not only an electrician, I'm a light bringer. That he said that, you know, that he feels that his task is not only about like this electricity, but he wants to bring light into people's lives. And one way he brings light into people's lives was like through just like putting the electricity together, which usually then like 10 people can put the lights on and off again. But the other thing was that he felt that because he was quite this social guy, he liked to like interact with people. He felt that by being an electrician, he's able to be he's invited to people's homes, to those kind of people's homes who otherwise don't invite anybody to their home. So many people, like they don't want anybody to come to their home, but even those people need an electrician in some situations. And so he felt that one rewarding part of his job was that he was able to get to these people's homes and interact with these people in their own home. And then like through that, like bring more light into their lives, probably, hopefully. So that was again like quite nice example how like craft one's both of one's interactions during one working day and also one's attitude towards one's own work. Okay, but now we like be still talking about this intrinsic motivation and this like when we go back to this first figure I was showing about this life management and life valuing, I guess like we have been now mostly talking about this life valuing dimension. And I was thinking that it would be that this last half an hour, it might be good to like talk about also about this life management dimension. And in order to talk about that, we might talk about this willpower. But I was thinking just very briefly, like you can like again discuss with the person next to you, like what would be like the most important willpower challenge you have in your life currently? What would be like the thing that you know that you're like fighting against some like urge or something like some thing, but you're not like sometimes you succeed, sometimes you fail. What would be like the most important willpower challenge you have currently in your life? So just for 1 minute, like try to figure out what would be like the thing that you find challenging as regards your willpower. It can be either in your work days or during your free time. Okay. Now that you have like discussed now that if you have like some willpower challenge in your mind, you can like when I introduce a couple of these tools that can improve one's willpower, like then you can think about would some of these tools be helpful in your own willpower challenge. But if you think about what is willpower, there's like some research showing that like at one-fourth of the time we are awake, we are fighting some urge in our life, you know, that one-fourth, like if you are awake 16 hours per day, at least 4 hours of those, we have like some urge that we are fighting against, you know, that we might be thinking that, you know, should I eat some candy or should I not eat some candy or chocolate, should I eat some chocolate or not, should I go exercising or should I not go exercising, should I do my work, should I work with this Excel sheet or should I go to see what's happening in Facebook. So we have like these challenges that we go through, like we have like in our everyday life is full of these like these small urges that we are fighting against. And so like according to one research, it was like fourth of our waking hours we are fighting against some urge, and in half of the cases we lose this fight, that we like give in to this urge and like just take the chocolate or look into the Facebook or something like that. And in order to understand this, that the psychology behind this, we have to understand that human beings are like kind of like not just like one mind. We are not like, we just don't have like just this one single mind which is like kind of like in control of everything. Like for example, there's this alarm clock called Clocky, which has like these wheels on the bottom of it. So when it starts like ring in the morning, it doesn't just like ring, but the wheels activate as well. So it like starts like spin around like the bedroom floor. So you have to like run after it and like to catch it. And if human beings would only have this one mind, then we wouldn't need this kind of thing, because like in the evening we would think that okay, I will wake up at 6:30 in the morning. And then in the morning when the alarm clock wakes us up, we said, okay, 6:30, so I want to wake up. And then I would like go to the shower and so forth. But like quite often we notice that actually the mind that decided that 6:30 is a good time to wake up is not the mind that wakes up at 6:30. and then that's why we often need these kind of different devices to make sure that, you know, that this mind, the evening mind, wins over this morning mind. And one way to think about this human mind is that we have like this dual process theory, that we have like this two way of like processing information and then thinking, that there's like this conscious mind and then there's like this intuitive mind. And a good metaphor of this is like this, that we have this the rider and the elephant. This metaphor is like from this psychologist Jonathan Haidt uses this metaphor, that there's this rider who's this conscious mind who's able to like think about things, like make plans, think about long-term consequences of things, and make these conscious decisions about what to do. And quite often the rider is thinking that he is in control of the life, but like at the same time there's this elephant, and actually the elephant, which is like this intuitive mind, is much, much bigger and much stronger. And this elephant is like, the elephant is not able to like think in the long term, but the elephant is more like just having this living in the now moment, think about what the elephant wants to do in the now moment. And if we want to like achieve these long-term goals in our life, it's not only about like having this rider wanting to do these things, but we have to like somehow train the elephant, somehow make sure that we get the elephant to come in the same direction that we want to be going towards. Because if the elephant wants to go in a different direction and the urge is strong enough, then the rider is just like hanging there and trying to like hold on to the ears in order to be like on top of the elephant. So like this is kind of like the basic dilemma of human beings, that we have this conscious mind with the long-term plans, big like conscious decisions about what one wants to do, and then there's this intuitive mind which is stronger and which always have these different urges towards different directions, which might not be in harmony with our long-term plans. And if you want to understand like the ability to do the right thing, So we have like consciously decided that this is the thing that we want to do. This is like the writer has decided that this is the way we want to be doing things. What are the ways we can make sure that we get towards this goal that we have decided to have? One is like through this power of the will, that we, our own will might be like getting us towards the direction that we want to go. And there's like this power of the intrinsic motivation, because like the most optimal situation would be that, you know, that the long-term goal, the big goal that we want to achieve, to strive towards, is also a goal that we are intrinsically motivated to strive towards, because then we don't need like much willpower to like achieve that goal, because that goal is kind of like pulling us towards itself. We want to be doing the thing, that we don't need like kind of push ourselves to do the thing. So that's kind of the most optimal situation. But then in life and in work, there's like quite many situations where like the thing that we needs to be done is not something that we are like not something that we are so intrinsically motivated to be doing. You know, doing the dishes at home or filling out the, like some travel like these receipts are not perhaps like the things that we like enjoy most about our work. And for that reason, we need this willpower, which has basically two parts. It has this part of the self-control, and the self-control is kind of like this part of the willpower, where I'm looking towards this like this urge and like looking it straight into the eyes and saying like that I'm not like doing it. For example, if it's like chocolate, I have an urge towards eating chocolate, then I look directly in the eye of this chocolate bar and say that I'm not eating you, I'm not eating you, I'm not eating you. For that we need the self-control. And then how to like increase the sense of self-control? And one thing to remember is like this that our blood glucose levels have like quite mixed effect on the self-control. That, you know, in some situations we have like much more self-control than in other situations. Like that when we have been like sleeping well, when we have been eating well, when we are relaxed, then we have like then our self-control is in much better shape than when we are sleep deprived or haven't been eating. So like in these situations we are much more prone to give in to the urge and not able to be like control our self. And there are funny research also showing that like you know that self-control used in one situation is also depleted in the other situations. Like so like there was this one study where there was like they put people in a room and they were like in the room there were like chocolate cookies and then there was some radish, this vegetable called radish. And half of the people were told that okay, you can eat as much radish as you want to, but don't touch the chocolate cookies. And half of the people were told that you're able to eat as much chocolate cookies as you want to, but don't touch the radish. And after that, they were brought to another room where there was this hand grip exercise machine, you know, the machine that you like pull like this, like to exercise your finger muscles. And then the researchers were looking at how long these people are able to pull this finger, this hand grip. And the thing was that like those people who had been fighting the urge to eat these chocolate cookies, who were not allowed to eat the chocolate cookies, they were able to pull this hand grip for a shorter time than the other people. So this willpower is in this sense quite like a muscle. That if you use willpower in one context, you will have less willpower in the next context. So during the day, if you have like some activities that which are kind of like are depleting your willpower, then in the next activities you probably have less of the willpower, and that's why we like in the afternoon you're more prone to give in to these urges. For example, to look at the Facebook or eat the chocolate or whatever is the urge. So that means that like we should like be quite wary of making sure that when we need the most willpower, then we have also the most willpower. And one way to make sure that we have this most willpower is that taking a nap or relaxing is like one important like way of like kind of like getting one's willpower levels up again if they have been like depleting through some activities. So like if I need to do some writing, like you know, have some article deadline coming up, so I need to do like quite much writing in the morning. If I do the writing like from 9 to 12, after that I start to feel that you know like my concentration levels go down. I'm not able to write as much as I wanted to. Then I reach the point where I'm just like staring at the screen with my fingers on the keyboard and all the time. Should I look at the Facebook or should I look at the email? And I'm not able to produce any more like kind of words on the paper. And in these kind of situations, one has to understand that the best thing that one could do for one's own productivity is not to sit in front of the computer anymore, but it's like to make a conscious choice that now I'm taking a break. Take a nap for 15 minutes or 20 minutes, or go for a walk in the nature, go for a walk around the block or something like that. Whatever one is doing, but like taking a conscious break is like quite a good way of like then making sure that the willpower is able to gain more willpower in the future. So like the only way I can like do effective writing in the afternoon is that I actually take some break, take a nap. I myself prefer to take like this 20 minutes power nap. That's my like way of like getting my willpower levels up again. But other people like other activities. But this conscious nap is usually like the best investment one can do for one's own productivity. But then willpower is not only about this self-control, but it's also about this sense of attitude. That there's also some research showing that you know that our beliefs about how much willpower we have actually affects how much willpower we have in different situations. That if I start some activity and already at the beginning of the activity I think that you know I will not be able to make this. If I go to run a marathon and from the first kilometer I think that okay I will not be able to make this, it's quite sure that I will like quit at some point because like when I have been running 10 kilometers and I feel like I feel tired and my feet is hurting, I think that what is the point of running like another 10 kilometers because then I will anyways quit. So if I don't believe in my ability to run the whole distance, I will never be able to run the whole distance. Only if I like from the beginning I have this like this strong feeling that I will be able to achieve this, then I will be able to achieve the thing. So the attitude that we have also matters quite much. And a couple of like kind of these tools to improve one's willpower as regards this attitude is like one thing is that to set clear targets for oneself. That there has been like research showing that you know that the more clear our targets are, the better we are like able to achieve those things. That if we only like, if I also decide that, okay, I want to like, you know, exercise more, that's like very bad target, because like it doesn't say like how much I'm exercising. But if I make the choice that, okay, I want to exercise 3 times a week, that's like much more like clear target, and it's much then it's much easier to like keep track of like if one is able to achieve the target or if one is not able to achieve the target. And it's even better like if in addition like make that decision that like what is the target, one is also to make the decision of when one is doing the thing, how one is doing the thing, and where one is doing the thing. That there was one research where they asked people to like make the decision to do they want to like donate blood in the next month. And half of the people were just asked to make this decision that do they want to donate blood or not. And half of the people were asked to make this decision, and after making this decision, think about when, where, and how they will do this blood donation. And it turned out that those people who just made the decision, only about 20% of those people actually donated blood. But those people who also made the decision about when, where, and how, of those around 60% donated blood in the next month. So setting clear targets and making sure that one has like clear idea of how, when, and where one is like trying to achieve those targets is one way of making sure that one has like this willpower to achieve one's goals. Other thing is that when one fails in the targets one is like trying to achieve, one way of reacting to this failure is like kind of like becoming angry at oneself. But research has shown that like becoming angry at oneself and punishing oneself usually is not the best strategy in order for learning from the mistakes. Because if you become angry at yourself, that's a state you don't want to be in. So like you quite quickly try to like get into another state and try to like forget this thing. Because every time you think about this thing, you start to get angry at yourself. But if you forgive yourself, you're much more able to think about think through the situation. What were the mistakes that led you to fail to achieve your task? Which means that you're able to like then in the future also make some corrections and then like better achieve the task that you have set yourself. So when you fail, don't get angry at yourself, but forgive yourself, and at the same time think consciously about what were the mistakes that you made that led to this like this failure, and think about how you could change the situation in the future. And then, but okay, so the one way to get to do the things that one has like one wants to get done is like through one's own will, through one's own like this intrinsic motivation and this willpower. But other way, that if one doesn't want to like kind of use up so much of one's willpower, one way is like then to make sure that one has like this necessary habits. So because like if I have like some strong habit, then I don't need any willpower like to fulfill this habit. For example, like when I wake up in the morning, I brush my teeth. That's something I've been like doing for like 30 years. So it's not something I really like consciously need to choose in the morning. Today I will brush my teeth. But it's something that I will like do quite automatically. I don't need any willpower for doing it. So if we are able to make something into a habit, we need less and less willpower to do that thing. And that means that, you know, that this willpower is spared tend to other activities. So making things into a habit is like quite a strong way of like making sure that one is able to get those things done. And a couple of like tools related to that is that first thing is that one who's like can I try to eliminate in order to have the willpower to those activities where one really needs, then one should like try to eliminate those activities from one's life where one doesn't like want to put one's willpower. For example, Barack Obama was once asked by a reporter that why he's always wearing the same kind of suits. It's always the same kind of suits that he's wearing. And the reporter was asked that, you know, why are you always wearing the same kind of suit? And he said that, you know, I have so many important decisions to be made during the day, during my working day, that I want to eliminate all the other decisions from my life. Like if I would have like different kinds of suit, every morning I have to make the conscious decision which suit I'm wearing. But now I have like 20 same color suits in my cupboard, so I just take the first that comes to my hand, and I don't have to like spend any effort in making that kind of choice. So eliminating like eliminating choices that one doesn't need to be making, and trying to like schedule these things like, as I already mentioned, that one should like make sure that one has like the most, that when one needs the most willpower, one should like make sure that one has the best energy levels. Other thing is that then like if one has like some big target in life, you know, some like long-term target, completing the dissertation, for example, it's very far away, like many years from now. It's quite hard to get the elephant on board on these kind of targets. Even though the conscious mind might think that it's a valuable target, the elephant is like more limited nowadays. So then one should like try to cut this big target into these more manageable sub-targets, which are like closer by, and also like attach some rewards to all these sub-targets. That if I get to that point, then I could reward myself by drinking a beer or taking some chocolate or taking a candy, or whatever is like the way one likes to reward oneself. But cutting big targets into smaller and more manageable like sub-targets, and then like having the rewards attached to these sub-targets is one way of like making sure that one is able to achieve things. And then also like measuring things and monitoring things is also one way that increases one's ability to achieve things. That the more one is like measuring things, that there has been also research showing that, for example, if people want to like kind of like lose weight, if the people go to the, what is the weight machine, or like this, I don't know what it's called, if one goes to the scale every day, then one is like more prone to lose weight than if one goes to the scale only once per month or once per week. Another research showed that, like, as regards this weight loss, that just writing down everything that one eats is also like one way of like try to like manage one's weight, because like quite often we are like eating things like even without even like ourselves noticing that we are eating these things. You know, that we are watching TV and at the same time taking some like snacks, and we don't even notice those things that we are how much we are eating those things. But if I had to write down everything I eat like on a paper, then I become like more conscious about what I'm eating, and that's already like one way of like increasing this like conscious control about what one is eating. So measuring and monitoring the things that one is doing, like nowadays, I guess like whatever one's willpower goal is, there might be like there is some application that one can like use to track down how one is like achieving that goal. It's also one like good way to make sure that one is achieving these goals. But if one wants to like get things done and doesn't want to like expend any willpower on that, the best way is like tend to tweak the environment to make sure that the environment is like kind of actually leading one to do the things that one wants to be doing. And as regards this, there's like this 20 seconds rule is like this one rule I want to mention, and it was like this Sean Aker, who was like this lecturer at Harvard, he came up with this 20 seconds rule. And the thing was that this Sean Aker, when he came home from work, he thought that his conscious mind was thinking that, okay, I want to read some books in the afternoon, in the evenings. But when he came home, he was tired, so he sat down on the sofa, then he put the TV on, and then he thought that, okay, I will start reading quite soon. And then like a couple of hours went by, and actually then he realized suddenly that, okay, I didn't have any time to read any books today. So he made this kind of change, that he took the batteries out of the remote control of the TV and put the batteries in this cupboard in his bedroom. At the same time, he put like some good books like next to the sofa. So the next time he came home from the work, he was sitting down at the sofa, and the remote didn't work, so he couldn't put the TV on. And the only way to get the TV on would be like to go get up and get to the bedroom, and that would take 20 seconds to get the TV on. And at the same time, the books were like next to him, so he could like just reach his hand to get the good book to his hands. So that meant that like suddenly he started to read much more and watch much less TV. So just having this 20 seconds barrier between the activity and action was the thinking and action was like able to like quite much influence what he was like doing in the next couple of hours. So that's something that one should really think about. If that one has like some challenges as regards willpower, how can one make sure that the environment is supporting one's target? You know, if one wants to like avoid something, how to make sure that the something that one wants to avoid is as far away as possible, that it's make that kind of from the time that you think about I would want it, to make sure that there's like at least 20 seconds like gap between before you can like get it, or even more. And on the other hand, if one wants to like do some things, how to make sure that like the gap between thinking and action is like as low as possible. The Sean Aker also, he wanted to like do more like go running every morning, but quite often in the morning he was like tired, and then he thought that, okay, where are my running shoes? I don't find them anywhere. I will skip it today. So then he started to do so that in the evening when he went to sleep, he put his running gear already on at that point. So he slept with his running gear on. So in the morning when he woke up, he already had this running gear on, so it was like quite hard for him to like not go running anymore. So that's like kind of like, so that's kind of like quite effective way of like making sure to get things done, is to make sure that the environment itself is kind of supporting oneself towards one's goals. And as regards environment nowadays, one has to like think that quite many things are happening on our computers, for example, this Facebook and stuff like that. Quite many urges happen there. So there are, luckily there are programs that one can put on a computer. There's like this program one can like have in the computer, which makes sure that one is not able to access certain web pages in the next couple of hours. So like one can, for example, I put like Facebook and YouTube or whatever pages there, and then like click the program on, and then like one knows that one is not able to access Facebook in the next couple of hours. So then it's easier to fight this urge to like go to the Facebook. And then other people, of course, are also like important. Like we also quite much do the things that other people around ourselves are doing. So if one has like some big life goal, like you know, one wants to quit smoking, it doesn't help if one goes to hang with the people who smoke. One really has to like change the social environment as well to make sure that the social environment is supporting oneself in one's goals. Okay, that was the willpower and part, and now we have like a couple of minutes. So I was thinking that now with 2 minutes left, it's like just good enough to tell you what is the meaning of life. Because that's a question I'd be like asked quite many times, because I have background in philosophy. So if I go to a bar, then somebody comes to ask from me like, so what is the meaning of life? And then I usually answer, okay, do you want to have the one sentence answer, or do you want to have the 2-hour lecture? And luckily most people want to have the one sentence answer. So I had this one sentence answer for quite many years already ready, and it's this. So meaning of life is to make yourself meaningful to other people. So the way to make my life meaningful is to make sure that I'm meaningful to other people. And this happens quite much through this relatedness and benevolence, because the way I'm meaningful to other people is like when other people care about me, or when I'm able to contribute towards other people, then I feel also that my life is meaningful. So like one of the best ways to make your life meaningful is to make yourself meaningful to other people. So this was my answer for quite many years, but then at one point I realized that this is actually only half of the answer. And I realized it when I was reading about this one surgeon who was like, kind of like, the surgeon was like very good in certain kind of heart operation, which meant that when the surgeon went to work, then came home, the surgeon was thinking, okay, I did three surgeries, so I saved three lives. So every day the surgeon was like saving people's lives. So in this sense, one cannot have like much more meaningful life. Like one is very meaningful to other people if one is saving their lives. But at the same time, the same surgeon like really felt that, you know, this is not something I want to do in life, this is not my thing that I want to be doing this thing. That he had ended up being surgeon because his parents were doctors. He had been good at school, so he went like, if you're good at high school, you go to this medical school. If you're good at medical school, you become a surgeon. So he went through this like kind of this pipeline without never stopping to think what he wants to do in life. And then when he stopped to think about what he wants to do in life, he realized it is something completely different than this occupation. So then he quit being a surgeon and started like training for another completely different occupation. So nowadays, when somebody asks me what is the meaning of life, I think like the better answer to the question is that like one should not only that meaning of life is not only about connecting to other people, but one also has to like connect to oneself. As Oscar Wilde has once said, that it's better to be yourself because everybody else is already taken. So nowadays my answer is that meaning of life is to do things that are meaningful to you in a way that makes yourself meaningful to other people. So you first have to find out what is the way, your way of self-expressing yourself, and then when you have like found that way, then like find out how to like make sure that you are like through that self-expression, you're able to somehow connect to other people and help other people. So that's like how, and that then connects also to this autonomy and competence as these basic needs. And nowadays, when people quite often talk about happiness, I think that, you know, happiness it's not so good life goal, that we shouldn't strive for happiness in our life. Because like it has been actually shown that, you know, those people who mostly strive for happiness are not so happy as other people, because they are not able to be satisfied with anything anymore. Whatever happens in their life, they're all the time thinking, okay, this made me slightly happy, but could it have made me even more happy? So like happiness is something that is not achieved by consciously trying to achieve it. Some things in life are more this side products that, you know, that you get them when you concentrate on some other things, and happiness is one of these things. And based on this, I took this, like when John Lennon once said that life is what happens to you when you're busy doing other plans. I just took this and like slightly modified it to better like suit this idea of happiness being the side product. And I will say so that happiness is what happens to you when you're busy doing meaningful things. That don't concentrate on happiness, just concentrate on doing these meaningful things. Concentrate on the self-expression and connecting with other people. And happiness then will just come without you having to think about it. And I think the same thought is also expressed by this author, George Bernard Shaw, whose quote I'm going to like now end up with this lecture. And he said so that this is the true joy in life. Being used for a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one. Being a force of nature instead of a feverish, selfish little clod of ailments and grievances, complaining that the world will not devote itself to making you happy. Okay, that's a quote I want to end you, like, leave you with. Thank you.